Morning children, and welcome back to your chemistry class. So today in this chapter of hydrocarbons, we will be discussing about the physical properties of alkenes and some of the chemical properties as well, right? So to begin with the physical properties, the first point that we should be knowing is that in the unbranched alkenes that contain four or less than four carbon atoms, they are always gases, right? So I mentioned it over here, unbranched alkenes with four or less than four carbon atoms, they exist in what form? Are the gases. They exist in the form of gases. For example, your ethene, it is a colorless gas of sweetish taste, right? Propene, C3H6, you have butene, C4H8, they are all gases under ordinary conditions. So example is like, as I told you, C2H4 or maybe C3H6 or maybe C4H8, these are all gases. Now second point, alkenes with 5 to 16 carbon atoms, they exist in the form of a liquid, okay? While those above 16 carbon atoms, they are solids. Followed? Then let's now talk about the boiling point of alkenes. They always increase with the increase in their molar mass, right? Increases with increase in molar mass, right? And this is why it is due to the increase in the van der Waal forces, right? So with increasing carbon contents, the increasing number of electrons per a molecule also increases, and therefore the boiling point also increases. Whereas the branched chain alkenes, they have lower boiling points than the straight chain. This is to be remembered. That is, branched alkenes have lower boiling point than straight chain alkenes. Fine. Then let's talk about the melting point. The melting point of all alkenes also show increasing trend with the increase in the molar mass. Increases with increase in molar masses. Right. Then there are some solubility of alkenes. Alkenes, they are insoluble in water. They are insoluble in water but are soluble in organic solvents, okay, such as your benzene or ether. So these were some of the physical properties of alkenes. Now we are going to discuss about the chemical properties of alkenes. So let us begin with the chemical properties of alkenes. The first one, so addition of halogens to alkenes. Addition of halogens. Okay. So when an alkene, it is treated with a halogen. Remember, addition reaction takes place rapidly across the carbon double bond, carbon bond of the alkene, and what it is going to form? It is going to form a vicinal dihalide, that is 1,2-dihaloalkane will be formed. For example, if you see the general reaction, this is your alkene. This is your alkene, right? This when combines with your halogen, suppose this is your halogen, okay, then what is it going to give you? As I said, it is going to give us vicinal dihalide. That is, the double bond is going to get removed. H will be here, H will be here, right? And then this H, this 1X will come here, 1X will come over here. So it forms 1,2-dihaloalkane. So let's take an example like C double bond C. What is this? This is your ethene, isn't it? When treated with, say, bromine, Br2, right? A halogen. So it is going to give us CHHHHBr and Br. So what is the name of this? This is 1,2-dibromoethane. Clear? I hope this point is clear. Similarly, if you treat it with chlorine, that is CH2 double bond CH2, when you heat it with chlorine, so it should give you a vicinal dihalide, that is CH2 CH2 Cl Cl, right? So this is 1,2-dichloroethane, right? Iodine, it reacts slowly with the alkenes and thus it is going to form 1,2-diiodoalkane. Now, which they are unstable and they eliminate iodine to regenerate the original alkenes, right? Fluorine, they cannot be added like you saw it in bromine and like chlorine, because it causes extensive fragmentation of alkene molecule. So I hope this is very clear. Basically, smooth reaction goes with bromine and with the chlorine. Next, we move to second reaction, that is addition of hydrogen. Okay, so alkenes, they add on hydrogen in the presence of certain metal catalysts, right? And they give the corresponding alkenes. So the process is called as catalytic. I hope you all can read. Catalytic hydrogenation, right? So hydrogenation reduction. So let's see over here, an alkene when treated with hydrogen. So as I said, in the presence of a metallic catalyst, it could be nickel or it could be platinum or palladium, right? And it is heated and it is going to give us the respective or the corresponding alkane, that is C, the double bond will change to single bond, H, no, not over here, let me show it to you like this, this H2 will come over here, okay? And this is going to form an alkane. So let's take an example over here, ethene if I take, right, and treated with hydrogen in the presence of these catalysts. So what am I going to get? C single bond C, H, H, H and H, and the two hydrogen over here. So what is this? This is called as ethane. C2H6, it is ethane, right? Similarly, if you take propene, CH3CH double bond CH2, right? And we add hydrogen to it, reduction will take place in the presence of the catalyst when heated to give us, if it is propene, it should give us propane. If it is ethene, it will give us ethane. So propane is what? CH3CH2CH3, right? So this hydrogenation, it is used in the manufacture of vanaspati ghee, if you remember, from the vegetable oil. And it is important step to prevent any rancidity of the vegetable oils containing double bonds. I hope till here it's clear.
Next one.
The third reaction is addition of halogen halides. Right? So over here, the order of reactivity of the halogen halide, you should know that is hydrogen iodide will be more than HBr and least will be for HCl. Right? So let's take an example here. Like CH2 double bond CH2, that is your ethene, when combines with HBr, it is going to give us CH3CH2Br, right? So over here, the addition of your halogen halide to the alkene, it is known as Markovnikov's, according to Markovnikov's rule. So now what is this Markovnikov's rule? According to this rule, the addition of your HBr or your H2O, whatever, to any of your unsymmetrical alkenes, it takes place in such a way that the negative part, right, of the adding of the molecule, it gets attached always to that carbon atom which possesses lesser number of hydrogen atoms. For example, let me show you. I am taking an unsymmetrical alkene. So CH3CH double bond CH2. What is the name of this? This is propene, right? I add the halogen halide, that is hydrogen bromide. Now, according to Markovnikov's rule, to that particular carbon atom which possesses lesser number of hydrogen atoms. So which one possesses lesser number of hydrogen atom? Here. So this bromine is going to get attached over here and not to this carbon or to this carbon. Clear? And thus the compound will be CH3CHBrCH3, and the name will be 2-bromopropane. Got it? I hope this is clear. Now, what are the conditions of applicability of this Markovnikov's rule? The Markovnikov's addition of your halogen halide to alkene, it always takes place in the absence of oxygen, right? Or maybe ultraviolet radiation and in the organic peroxide case. Then next, let us understand how does anti-Markovnikov's rule also is applied when addition of peroxide takes place to the alkene. That is, in the presence of peroxide, when we add HBr to any unsymmetrical alkene, then it is just the opposite of Markovnikov's rule. So let's see this. For example, CH3CH double bond CH2, and I am adding HBr, but here I am also adding peroxide. Got it? When I add peroxide to this mixture, then it is not going to follow Markovnikov's rule. Then it is going to follow anti-Markovnikov's rule, which is also called as Karasch effect, right? And thus, over here, what are we going to see? The product form will not be 2-bromopropane, but it will be 1-bromopropane. That is CH3CH2CH2Br, right? And this is called as anti-Markovnikov's rule or Karasch effect. Okay, they are important. So what you can understand is 2-propene, when we add the halogen halide, it is going to give us two products. One will be 2-bromopropene, one will be 1-bromopropene. But the two are formed in different rules. That is, when simply you are adding the halogen halide to the propene, then it follows Markovnikov's rule, that is your HBr is going to get attached to that the negative ion of HBr, that is the bromine, it is going to get attached to that carbon which has less number of hydrogen atoms. But to that same reaction, if we add peroxide, then it is going to act anti-Markovnikov's rule, means just the opposite, it is going to form one bromopropane, that is also called as Karasch effect, and that is going to form at the first place. I hope this point is clear. Now, only HBr, remember, it shows a peroxide effect or it shows Karasch effect, whereas HCl does not show Karasch effect, right? Now, why so? Because HCl bond is stronger than your HBr bond, right? And HCl is not cleaved by the free radical, whereas Hi bond is weaker and they can be easily cleaved, and iodine free radicals, they combine to form iodine molecules instead of adding to the double bond. So I hope this is very clear to you, that propene, remember, propene adds with HCl and with Hi in the presence of peroxide, then it is going to follow Markovnikov's rule, right? So over here with HBr, it is going to, in the absence of peroxide, it is Markovnikov's rule. In the presence of peroxide, it is Karasch anti-Markovnikov's rule. Which one am I talking about? Propene, right? But if that same propene you treated with HCl, right? That same propene, CH3CH double bond CH2, if treated with HCl, even in the presence of peroxide, then HCl, as I told you, it is stronger than HBr and it is not cleaved, right? Therefore, it is going to follow which rule? Markovnikov's rule, and it is going to form over here CH3CH CH3Cl, that is 2-chloropropane. So once again I say that propene, it adds HCl and Hi, similarly you can do in the presence of peroxide, but still it follows Markovnikov's rule. But if we add HBr with peroxide, then it is going to follow anti-Markovnikov's rule. Till here, I hope it's clear. Okay, next. Fourth one. Addition of sulfuric acid. Okay, addition of sulfuric acid. Now this also follows Markovnikov's rule, right? So let's see over here. CH2 double bond CH2 plus, if we look at the concentrated sulfuric acid, OH double bond O double bond O, right? It is going to give us, this is going to give us CH3CH2OSO2OH. What is this called as? Ethyl hydrogen sulfate. Okay. Then let's talk about propyl. Let's talk about propene, that is CH3CH double bond CH2, that is propene. When treated with concentrated sulfuric acid, HOSO2OH, I have written it in this form, it is going to give us propyl hydrogen sulfate, that is CH3CH CH3OSO2OH. What is this? This is your propyl hydrogen sulfate. Clear? Now, addition of fifth one, addition of water. So let's look at this reaction. CH3C double bond CH2CH3. This is your 2-methylpropene. When we add in the presence of an acid, right, then only the reaction takes place and it forms an alcohol. That is CH3C CH3CH3OH. An alcohol is formed, that is 2-methylpropentol. Clear? I hope till here it's very clear to all of you. Ordinarily, water does not add to the alkene, but definitely in the presence of an acid, the water adds to form more reactive alkenes and therefore they form the alcohols, right? Now let us understand oxidation reactions of alkenes, right? So alkenes on reaction with cold dilute aqueous solution of KMnO4, which is also called as Baer's reagent, right? They give us vicinal glycols. So decolorization of KMnO4 solution, it is used as a test also for unsaturation, right? So 2KMnO4 plus water first is going to give us MnO2 plus 2KOH plus 3 nascent oxygen, right? So this nascent oxygen is going to combine with the alkene at 273 Kelvin with your dilute KMnO4, and it is going to give us glycol, that is the vicinal glycol CH2CH2OHOH. So what is this called as? This is called as ethane 1,2-diol. Clear? Take another example propane. So CH3CH double bond CH2 plus H2O and your nascent oxygen in the presence of dilute KMnO4 at 273 Kelvin. It is going to give us CH3CH, CH2OH, and so this is again propane 1,2-diol. Clear? I hope this is clear to all of you. This was the first reaction. Then talking about the next one, oxidation with acidic KMnO4. Or maybe with acidic KMnO4, or maybe your acidic K2Cr2O7 or hot KMnO4. Okay, so over here terminal alkenes. Right? What am I talking about? Terminal alkenes, that is a double bond at the end of the carbon chain. They are oxidized by hot KMnO4. Right? One of the product will always be methanoic acid, which will further get oxidized to give us carbon dioxide and water. So let's see this. CH2 plus oxidation takes place over here, firstly in the presence of hot KMnO4. So what did I say? Firstly, it is going to form the oic acid, that is over here it is going to form formic acid, HCOOH. This is your formic acid, further which on oxidation will give us carbon dioxide plus water, right? Let's see another example like CH3CH double bond CH2. Okay, So this is going to also give us, in the presence of your hot KMnO4, ethanoic acid, that is CH3COOH, ethanoic acid, which further on oxidation, right? Which further on oxidation, you should write like this, will give us carbon dioxide plus water, right? So this I'm talking when? I'm talking about the terminal alkenes. Now, let's talk about non-terminal alkenes. Now let's check the non-terminal alkenes on oxidation. They give carboxylic acids and or maybe ketones depending upon the nature of the alkene. So if we take butene, that is CH3CH double bond CHCH3. What is this? This is butene, right? On oxidation, in the presence of your hot KMnO4, it is going to give us, it is butene, so it is going to give us ethanoic acid, that is CH3COOH, two molecules of ethanoic acid. But if we take 2-methylproptoene, that is CH3C double bond CH2CH3. What is this? 2-methylproptoene, right? On oxidation in the presence of hot KMnO4, then it is going to give us a ketone and a carboxylic acid. That is H3C double bond C double bond O. This is your proptoone. The ketone is formed, and HCOOH, that is your formic acid, is formed. Further, which on oxidation will give us carbon dioxide and water. So what did I say? The non-terminal alkenes on oxidation, they give carboxylic acid also, and or along with it ketones depending upon the nature of the alkene, right? Over here you can see it is giving you only carboxylic group, but here it is giving us both ketone and carboxylic group, right? Then next we come to ozonolysis. So over here, ethene undergoes ozonolysis, or maybe in the presence of carbon tetrachloride, and it is, because it is ethene, it is going to form ethene ozonoid, that is CH2O. What is this called as? This is your ethene ozonoid. Right, further, which when treated with zinc plus water, then zinc oxide will be given out. Okay, zinc oxide will be given out, and an aldehydic group will be formed, that is two parts of HCHO. ZnO will be given out, then it is going to form HCHO2 aldehydic methanol will be formed over here. Methanol will be formed here. Got it? Take another example of propene. CH3CH double bond CH2 in the presence of ozone or carbon tetrachloride is going to form CH2O, right? So what is this? This is your ozonoid, okay? Propene ozonoid. So this further, in the presence of ZnO and H2O, zinc oxide will be given out. So if you remove this oxide, what are you going to get? you will get CH3CHO, right? This is one, and what is the other one? Plus HCHO, the other aldehydic group will be formed. So two aldehydic group will be formed. What is this? This is ethanol and this is methanol. Clear? Last of the reactions in the alkenes. Polymerization now. Okay? So over here, simple molecules called as monomers, they undergo combination in the presence of high temperature, high pressure, in the presence of catalyst, and the whole process, what is it called as? Polymerization, and they form large molecules which are called as polymers. So ethene, you know, it forms polyethene. So n molecules of ethene under, what did I say, high temperature, right, high pressure, as well as in the presence of the catalyst, it is going to form polyethene. How do we write that? CH2 n times. This is your polyethene, right? If you take a propene, n molecules of CH3CH double bond CH2 under high temperature, high pressure and catalyst, it is going to give us polypropylene, that is CH CH2 and CH3. What is this? Poly word has to be written because n molecules have been added up over here, and it is what? Propylene. Okay, so polymers, they are used for the manufacture of your plastic bags or your squeeze bottles, your refrigerated dishes or pipes or toys or the TV cabinets, etc., right? And this polypropene, it is used for the manufacture of your milk crates, if you have seen that thick plastic, or the plastic buckets and all that. So with this, we finish off with the alkenes today. The next chapter that I shall begin with will be the alkynes. Thank you.